like to say a thank you to Rev Unit and Mike Palladino for hosting. It's very nice to be able to use this space. The objective of the Computer Science Club was to bring something new to the community where people can learn things, showcase what people are interested in or good at or whatever, and also have a venue for practice with presentation, because it turns out to be very handy for your day-to-day life. Like if you're having to do a presentation at work or something, having a lot of bonus practice. So what are we doing here this evening? This self-balancing tree thing kind of blew into a larger thing than I thought it was going to, because it's actually very important. So, and it's not even really the trees and the self-balancing issue that I think is the important part of the presentation. So some of the things that we'll talk about while we're here are these trees and so forth. Other structures we're talking about are all ordered. So everything here is going to be an ordered structure. And so a lot of things have some similarity because of being ordered. And what we're going to really be focusing on with going from something like a linked list to a tree and a structured tree that's balanced is being able to have some sort of guarantee for some operations that are big O of log N instead of big O of N, which is a really enormous difference. Because if you had a billion elements in one of these data structures and the best you could do is big O of N, then you have some time it takes to insert, delete, or determine membership on the order of a billion time units. Whereas with a binary tree, you have on the order of 30 time units. So it's a stunning difference if you can make that leap to be log N versus N. And there's also the relationship with expressions, because trees can be written in terms of expressions. And that's very important because expressions are able to be computed without side effects. And so we're going to talk a little negative on some things like arrays here in a minute, but the ability to make something that's in terms of expressions is hugely important for breaking up a problem and being able to parallelize the problem. And so we'll see pretty clearly why trees are parallelizable. And an example of why this is important, I mean, the world's just going in this direction. Processor speed is sort of curving off where it is, and how you get performance gains is by having more cores. And there's a lot of interesting players in this arena in CPUs these days. Nowadays, maybe a good CPU like a high-end Xeon might have 32 cores, but there's this other group of people who make graphic cards that are probably really where the most interesting stuff is. And if you think about the data structures that you use for doing 3D modeling, they're all graphs which are related to the trees, and they all have expression evaluation to render whatever you're wanting to render. And these guys long ago realized that to get low power and to get high performance, they need to have a bunch of cores. So actually, it's not Xeons and the Intel-type processors that are really where the CPU power is these days. It's on things that have simpler CPUs and many more of them. So like from NVIDIA, currently it's like on their main page on the site, their current graphics card is targeted to deep learning, not to graphics. They build a special box that has it for deep learning and machine learning, because that one graphic card has almost 6,000 CPUs on it. And if you have a problem that you can express in a way that you can get benefit out of this many processors, then that's exactly what you need. And so that's kind of the undercurrent of this presentation is, if you want speed and you want to be able to do big problems, you have to think about these problems in terms of how you can break it down. And if you have something like a linked list or something like that, you just can't break it down the same way as you can with trees. So they're very fundamental. So the first structure that we want to briefly touch on is an array. And I'm going to go through these structures and just kind of touch on pros and cons, because obviously there's places where arrays are the right structure. An array is just a block of memory that's partitioned into, maybe there's n blocks, n partitions for some certain type. So maybe it's an integer, maybe it's a 64-bit integer, or it's a fixed length string, or it's a floating point, or whatever. some of the pros of an array are that indexing is really easy because you just have a pointer to the beginning of each one of these cells. And some of the other things that are really good about them are, if you're a smart compiler, you can place this structure somewhere on a cache boundary for the processor, so you have very good cache performance. And it's very organized. It's all within this little block that's very, you know, deterministic, where it lives, how it performs. So for problems like FFTs or something like that, where you really need excellent performance and you want to get value out of your cache, then, and the problem is very naturally something where you have sort of a small amount of indexed information that's the same type, then something like an array is a really good choice. But it's also very inflexible. You're not going to be interested in making a bunch of system calls to malloc or something to resize this thing, and you're probably not, as a general programmer, in the business of writing your own memory manager. So you pretty much get what you want, and then you have to run with it for that problem. And generally speaking, things having to do with arrays are not things that are able to be evaluated as expressions. You almost always will have some sort of pointer I or something that has the ability to have side effects that will cause you troubles. So the next most general thing that you can do to generalize on this idea of the array is to have a linked list. And so your linked list, oops, I'm drawing on myself. A linked list is fundamentally a very different kind of data structure, because instead of being a full block of memory, it's just a type that has a value and a pointer to itself. So it's a self-referential type or a recursive type, whatever you want to call it. So what's really cool about this is if you want to add something to it, you can just point it to the next, create a new one of these types and add a new value. And if you want another one, you can add a new value. And say if you wanted to delete a value, all you have to do is come up with some sort of clever mechanism where you can reattach this guy over to here and get rid of this one. So the ability to dynamically change how these guys are connected as small building blocks that store information is very substantial. So with some of the code that we'll look at, probably ought to get that started, probably about time to make this computer run. Is there some sort of intermission music here?
No.
For the unprepared. Okay, so let's do some pros and cons. Pro is, before we looked at some of the code here, pros of a linked list are that it's very easy to change the size. I mean, it's a dynamically resized type. There is no real, this has 10 elements. It's however many you really want. They all evaluate as expressions. So if you were starting to stack these things up, you can make an expression that will evaluate to find anything you want in that linked list. The cons are, like we know, they have linear performance. And that is to say, anytime we're talking about performance in the computational complexity class, you want to think about the worst case. So if you had 10 items in a row, and you wanted to see if some number was an element of that group of items, the worst you could have to do is go through all of them and that one matches. Of course, the best you could do is you could match on the first one and you're golden. But whether you're inserting or you're deleting or you're checking membership, the worst case situation is you have to go through all of them. So any problem where you're forced to go through all of them, all n items would be a big O of n time. And to some degree, there's more challenging reasoning about how you would index things. It's not as clear, like from the perspective of table of contents in a book, that page one was the first thing, page two was the second thing. You have more of a recurrence relationship because this guy's pointer points to another one. So it's beginning to be a little bit more cerebral, I guess, in terms of how you would evaluate these things. And so we need to look at some code to see, since this was all going to be get done in OCaml, because I like OCaml a bunch. And so if you were going to generate a type. You just make a type, and the tick A is a polymorphic type. It really means alpha, but alpha is not a evident character. And it's either empty or it's a node that is the cross of some value, tick alpha, and one of our linked lists that we're already using. So it's self-referential or recursive definition of whatever you want to call it. If you're checking the membership, you just, if the thing's empty, you return false. If the thing is, if there's some node to look at, then either the thing you're testing against is equal to the value, or you need to recursively do it to the next one down that list. And then with insert, if you're going to insert some node in here, and this guy has a value 1, and this guy has a value 2, say, you just keep going, and you want to insert the value 3. You've got a couple options here. You get to 2, you see that you're at the end. Well, you can put 3 in there and link to it. If you wanted to insert the value 0, and you find that you have the value 1 is the first thing, then you put your new node 0 in, and then link to what you've got. And then the other option is that you were equal. If you wanted to insert a 1, and you were a 1, so you can just, this thing you already know, so you just get rid of that case. There's a lot of ways that you can get rid of that case. Delete's pretty much the same thing, you're just unlinking things. If you wanted to get rid of the node that has the 1 in it, you find that node, and then you link the 0 to the next one. And a lot of these steps are actually really pretty easy if you're into recursive kind of operations. But like we said, the trouble is you have at best big O of N performance, and that kind of, well, that's just not going to cut it if you've got a billion data points. So in this presentation, there's like a couple things. There's that thing about parallelism and how that's going to be really important in the future, or is important now. And there's a couple sections where it goes from one kind of idea to the next that are pretty important. And this one, I think, is probably one of the biggies. Previously, we had a type that had a value and then a pointer to itself, say. And that gives you things like linked lists. The big step that you can make beyond that is a value. I know, it's crazy, two pointers. So this gives you an enormous class of things that you can do with it. You can make things that are doubly linked lists, where this guy can refer to the one before it and the one previous to it, and that can be a useful way to solve some problems if you want to go forward or backward. It can give you the ability to make things that are more general than trees, like graphs that might have cycles in them. And we're just not going to consider this. So just by adding the two pointers instead of one in this type, you have an enormous family of problems that you could solve, and we're just solving a little section of them. So no cycles, no doubly linked lists, just plain old binary trees. As well, in the family of trees, there's quite a large number of trees. There's nothing really preventing you from having 25 pointers in that type. It just would be very difficult to see what's going on. So humans tend to like binary trees because they make better sense. And because if you have values and they're ordered, less than, greater than works really well with binary, and it doesn't work really well with having 5 subtrees. So if we were going to draw a just random ordered binary tree, slow down, or it'll look bad. That's enough of this tree. So every time you have a value in this tree, everything in the left subtree is a smaller value, and everything in the right subtree is the larger value. No big deal. That gives us a very easy to think about invariant, which is just a property of this data structure that has to always hold. everything on the right has to be bigger and everything on the left has to be smaller. And this is true not only of this node, but it's true of this node and this node and this node and this node. So anywhere in this tree, the 5 has a smaller node to the left and a larger node to the right. 30 has larger on the right and smaller on the left. Everywhere it does the same thing. And we can already see why having the ability to balance a tree gives us something useful. Because
is there a name for that class of tree?
Some people use binary search tree. I have decided I like ordered binary tree, just to highlight that it's ordered.
So you say ordered binary tree, that means it follows a rule you just said.
Mm-hmm. There's ordering to the elements and there's only the 2 subtrees. There isn't anything preventing, and there's plenty of types of trees that people use where your node has 2 values and you have 3 subtrees. That's just, for this sort of presentation, it's not very useful to have the added complexity. And in general, the more of that you have going on, the more challenging the code is, the more error prone the code is, and the slower the code is. There's a big balance that you have to get into whenever you're thinking about what element of this performance or aspect of performance is most important to you. And there's just tons of options, but we're doing just the binary trees. So
is there a restriction on the values of the nodes? They can't appear but one time in each of these?
If you
they're unique, in other words?
They're unique.
Okay.
Because if this was something and you tried to insert a 20, it would be the same as it's already there.
Okay.
There are trees where you have duplicates and so forth, but things that a person might use these trees for would be dictionaries and so forth.
Yeah.
So you have a unique and orderable sort of key, and priority queues, which are all ordered things. So this tree isn't the most balanced that you could make it. I'm not even going to put the numbers. Yeah. If you made this ordered tree, it's as full as they can get. There is no child tree in here at all that's unfilled. For example, in this one, that does not have children, and this guy did not have a left subtree, and this guy did not have children. So that one's not very fully populated. This is the fullest that you could make a tree, or the widest, the most balanced. I'm not sure that there even is really a term for what the most balanced is, but this you could say is the most balanced. And this is really the goal that we have, because if you wanted to find any element in here, the most time it takes is to go from the root to one of the leaves. And so basically the number of steps you have is the height of the tree. And the height of the tree is log n. If there's n elements in the tree, then the height is, log base 2 of n. So that's kind of interesting. If you could have a balanced tree, and it's a binary tree, you can make a problem go from big O of n to big O of log n for its performance just by going from a data structure that has one pointer to another one of itself to one that has 2. And I think it's kind of amazing, really. The trouble with ordered binary trees in general that are not forced to have some sort of structure that makes them balanced is there's a lot of pathological cases. For example, if you were doing sequential number inserts, you would have a 1, and now we're going to insert a 2. This guy has an empty subtree. Insert a 3. Insert a 4. Insert a 5. There really isn't anything going on here that's any different than a linked list, other than you're wasting space with these left subtrees. So that's the trouble with ordered binary trees that are not balanced, is you have no guarantee that you would have log n performance. You have guarantee that you have n performance. So it's imperative that we figure out how we could make this tree balanced. So a few things that we've got to look at on at, with these guys is how, just from the ordered binary tree perspective, is how you would add an element or delete an element and that sort of thing. It's actually not really much of any different than a linked list for the insertions and for membership. Membership's really almost identical. You either, you start here, you have a candidate, you want to see if 7 is an element. You start here at 7 bigger than 5, yes. Well, I better recursively try the right subtree. If, you know, if you didn't get to 7 because this was like 6 or whatever, then you just keep doing it. Is 6 less than 7? Yes. Well, I better try the right subtree. So you just sort of recurse down that tree until you either find your element or you get to an empty child and an empty child returns false for the membership. If you're wanting to insert somebody, you want to insert a 7, you traverse the tree fairly similarly. We're inserting a 7 as 7 greater than, equal to, or less than 5, it's greater. Well, I better see what's going on down here. I get to my 6, is it greater? Oh, there wasn't a node down here. This was an empty node, so I guess it goes here. So you just sort of splice him in there. And deleting with 0 or 1 children is basically the same thing. If you wanted to delete, the 7, you just get down to the 7, it has empty child nodes, and just take him out of there and replace him with an empty. If you wanted to delete, who's another one to delete that would be good? If you want to delete this 6, it has 1 non-empty child tree node, and that's pretty easy. You just find the 6, notice that he has only the 1 subtree, and then replace this guy with that and delete it. The tricky one, this is really generally true of any tree thing, the trickiest thing ever is deleting an element where it has 2 non-empty children. So let's see. So if we wanted to delete the 10, it's a much more interesting, I mean, it's not really hard to code it up, but it's a much more interesting procedure, and there's 2 ways that you can go about it. You can either, you want to delete this guy, you can replace this guy with the smallest element of the right subtree, and then delete the 12, and then you notice everything over here is still less than, everything over here is still greater than, and it just happened to be the case that the smallest element moved up here and then got deleted. So if you do it this way, you find the smallest element, replace this guy's value, and then recursively delete this element. Then you just say, delete the 12 out of this subtree. So it's really not very difficult to code it, but it's not entirely clear at the beginning how you would do it. The other option is you can take that action on the left. You can find the largest value over here and replace it, and then recursively delete on the left. So you could also have moved the 7 up here and then deleted the 7. And you still have a tree, and it still obeys all of the ordering that a tree has for the invariant. But this is kind of interesting. If you're deleting elements, you can end up with totally different trees that are still perfectly valid trees, and they have completely different form. So what we really need to talk about is how you balance these guys. I think I'm just going to skip the code till sort of at the end, just because it probably doesn't do very well to like bounce back and forth. So there's a bunch of different tree balancing methods. There's tree balancing methods that have to do with non-ordered binary trees. Things that people recognize are probably like 2-3 trees and B trees and splay trees and whatnot. And then there's a family of algorithms for the ordered binary trees. We're going to do red-black because markers come in red and black, which is pretty close to the reason why they're red-black to begin with. And then there's also AVL trees and AA trees, which are pretty common in that family. And the reason the red-black trees are called red-black trees, is actually almost the same thing. It was some guys at Xerox PARC who came up with this scheme, and they were interested in having a good presentation, and they realized that their printer printed best in red and black. So they printed all of their slides in red and black, and then the name ended up staying. This also makes it oodles more difficult to draw things since you've got the two colors. So first off, we'll get rid of this tree over here. And the only reason you go to all this effort for this stuff and spend, you know, millions of man hours messing around with trees and how you would balance them is because if you're getting to have large problems, you're not going to get anywhere in life unless you have some guarantee of the complexity and the ability to parallelize these things. So if you want to do large problems ever in your life, you're going to have to do something along the lines of balancing trees. So here's a valid red-black tree. This is going to go slower in practice than I thought, drawing in two colors on a board. It's also almost universally the case, and I would not want to slight any sort of historical precedent on this, that almost invariably people talk about the insert cases and then kind of hand wave over the delete cases for red-black trees. Because somewhat how the delete case for a regular order binary tree has a little bit more going on than the inserting does, the red-black trees have a bunch of cases that you have to look at, and there's just not, it's not worth the time talking about it because no one's going to remember what they are, and they can look at the code later when it gets posted and whatever if they're interested. So we'll look conceptually at deleting and like a couple cases of how that works, and we'll do all the insert cases because there's not many. But it's kind of funny, if you go looking around anywhere in any book almost on algorithms, they're like, that's the homework assignment, the delete cases. I'm not going to do that one. You better let those crazy kids to work out all those delete cases. So if you're into colors and you're into, I don't know, sorry about this, the hyphen things, it kind of muddles it up. The colors really are the node where the value is. This is a valid red-black tree, so we need to talk about the invariants for a red-black tree that have to hold for this game. All of these algorithms are kind of a little game, kind of like playing poker or something. They just have a collection of rules they have to hold in order to meet the criteria and some kind of method that you can use to keep it that way. So the red-black tree rules are all of the paths from the root node to the children have the same number of black nodes. So in this case, this path has two, this path has two, even though it comes down to a red child. This guy has two, and this guy has two. So check on that one. The next invariant is that red nodes can only have black children, or otherwise red nodes cannot have red children. So this works on here. No red node has a red child. If you did something like this, you would have broken that invariant. If you did something like this, you would have broken the invariant having to deal with the number of nodes in any path from the root to the child. There's a weak invariant that the root node is always black, which we'll run into with the insert case. And this is, I would say, kind of a quasi-invariant, but the children are generally, like if it's an empty subtree, it's generally considered to be black. So you could, if you wanted to, draw in all these empty nodes everywhere. That doesn't affect anything about the count. If you actually counted these, all of those would have three instead of two. But since it's applied universally across every child, it doesn't really affect the height at all. And the reason it comes up being useful is when you're doing the delete cases, you want to bubble up some information from those children having to do with their structure. And so having a notion of them being colored makes some sense for that. So some pros, if we were going to have balanced trees or red-black trees, is we actually end up with a guarantee of the computational complexity. And that's a pretty big thing. And you have, kind of related to that, a guarantee about the structural balance, like how imbalanced this tree could be at worst. The cons are that because you're tracking color with this type, you have a little bit extra data that you're kind of hauling around with you. Previously, we had a type that had a value, a pointer, and a pointer. And now, whoa, that's not an arrow. Now we have something that has a color value, and a pointer, and a pointer. So when you're trying to keep a tree balanced, you have to carry all this extra information with you. And it's kind of interesting because it's very distributed in the tree. So you want this type to be able to accommodate all of this. You don't want some supportive data structure to be able to tell you about the balancing. All the games having to do with balancing trees all keep information within the base type. But it is sort of a con, because if you were really concerned about space and you knew that your problem was structure, which probably happens incredibly infrequently, you could get away with not carrying along this color. And the code complexity becomes much higher compared with most of these others. And it's only because there's a lot of cases, and it's only because they're much more challenging to reason about. So
you infer the color from the structure?
You
in your code, if you were doing that.
If
you weren't carrying the color.
If you weren't carrying the color, you really probably couldn't make any of the balancing happen. You could
But if you were to say the rule is, I have the red-black tree, but I don't carry the colors, but I could infer which color there was, if I started with the black, which you always do, then I can infer the color all the way down the scheme just by the fact that it is invariant, right?
For some trees, you could probably do that. If it was too far out of balance, for example, if you had a tree that was like...
But it wouldn't be a red-black tree then.
Then you could color it red-black.
Yeah.
Because you'd never be able to meet the criteria. So,
but if I know it's a red-black tree, I don't need to know the color at each node, necessarily.
If you knew it was red-black tree,
yeah,
then I suppose you could infer the colors.
Yeah.
Or there probably are several colorings, I would imagine, that would be valid for most, and especially larger trees. And you could probably come up with one of them. So I want, like, if you consider something has a fixed number of the first invariant, the black height of the tree, and we'll just say it's 2, and I'm just going to draw dots, not really like numbers. That is a tree that is fully satisfying. It has a black root node. It has constant height with the children. There is no red, so there's no issue with red subchildren of red. And the other thing that you could do that has height too, well, another thing that you could do that has height too is this is going to be visually challenging for people farther back because it is way too small. This tree here also has black height too, but it's completely the opposite in that you have reds interspersed as much as possible. So this is as far unbalanced as a tree of height 2 could be. You could have this case, or you could have this case that has the reds interleaved with it. And both of these are valid height 2 red-black trees. This guy has 3 data points, and this guy has 15 data points. So the amount of unbalance is something that's addressed in these different algorithms for making balanced trees. Some, like a red-black tree, at most, height-wise, the smallest it could be that's balanced versus the biggest it could be, height-wise, is a factor of 2 different for example, on AVLs, it's more of 1.5 different in that ratio.
Yeah.
I imagine that you'll get to it, but one thing that I'm wondering about right now is that looks like it's 4 high, not 2.
It's 4 total nodes high, but the black height is, there's just 2 black heights tall.
Right.
So and what you're saying is the bigger the node, the more smaller little numbers it takes to make a bigger one?
Maybe. I'm not totally sure. There is an opportunity for something that has the same, one of the properties to be a bigger tree or a smaller tree. And the reason you pick one method of doing it versus another, say the AVL tree, red-black trees have a 2-to-1 difference in imbalance, height-wise, and maximum. The AVL trees have about a 1.56-to-1 difference in imbalance height-wise at worst. So if you were interested in a problem where you were going to do it by parallelizing the problem and you wanted to dole out portions of work to one processor or to another, this has a pretty big mismatch in terms of the total number of nodes. So you might want to choose something that will result in a little bit more balanced data structure. On the flip side, this has pretty easy inserts and so forth that are not computationally expensive. So if all you're interested in is shoveling data into something, a red-black tree might be the best approach. But you pick them pretty much because of the properties that they have and the application that you have. So much like the other trees, regular order trees, insert and membership are basically, membership's basically the same. Membership's the same no matter what kind of tree it is. You're just checking if you've got the value until you find it. I didn't delete that. So this red thing, I have yet to find any sort of text that really uses this language choice for this, but I'm gonna say these red nodes are slack nodes, if you will, because if you took something that was perfectly black tree, all black, and you wanted to add a node, you couldn't add a black. You need to have something that meets the criteria for the invariance, but allows you to insert something. So you can insert a red node. So I'm gonna say red nodes are kind of like slack nodes because they allow you to insert something that otherwise wouldn't fit with an all black tree. And they're very important how they operate. So when you're doing inserts, it's kind of, how you would come up with the way that you choose these invariants and enforce them to find this is sort of a magical mystery of smart computer science people. But how you actually in practice process this for doing an insert is remarkably easy. Anytime you see the red nodes, there's an opportunity to potentially take something that's relatively unbalanced and collapse it into something that's a little bit more balanced. So if you think about these four structures, this is supposed to be a tree with the black nodes, and there's these are children trees, child trees, areas where there could be children trees, and we'll just call them A, B, C, and D, because A, B, C, and D are in order, and clearly this one's more left of the other ones, so they're kind of going in order. If these are ordered, then you could rearrange this general idea and keep that order. Yes?
You've got two reds.
I know.
Okay.
This is a case when we make an insert, and we insert something, we'll call it red, and then if we end up with this, we're gonna fix it later. The red-black trees are all about messing up the invariant and then fixing it in another step. So you usually will insert a red, see what happens, and then find it. And what happens here is if we inserted this node, say, and we called it red, we have this information because we've got this red child of red, that doesn't meet the invariant, what it basically means is there's an opportunity because of this to reorganize this tree. So within this structure, because of the coloring, you have some inferred ability to reorganize it. So I'm going to draw three more of these that are like very kind of non-apparent trees. But what's interesting about them is these three or four, I mean, four things are, what the heck's going on here? Get out. This is very hard actually to copy this over and it like makes sense to you while you're drawing. What really this is it's a list of all trees that have four subtrees. So every one of these, this is every, for having three nodes in it and four subtrees, it's all of the combinations you could possibly make that preserve the order. And in every case, you have something that was inserted that broke the invariant by adding a red node under a red node. And the fun thing about this is check this out. It's kind of, this is where red-black trees are like super clever, in my opinion. If you replaced this, with one red that has two black subchildren, then you have something that very clearly looks a little bit more orderly and a little bit more like a perfectly balanced tree. And what happens is when you make this insert, when you're evaluating this expression for insert, you drive down the tree until you notice that you're going to insert this. Every time you're using a insert function to insert this value until you find it. So if you replace these trees with one that has a red top node, then as that thing unwinds, going back up, evaluating the inserts, if it runs into another one of these red nodes, because it was one of these children of a red node, then you found another opportunity because you broke the invariant to reduce some of the slack from in the red nodes. So if this guy was replaced with this and it happened to be a child of a red node, then you're going to be able to do this process again and again and again until you get back up to the top of the tree.
And then you just make it black.
Just make it black?
If the red one ends up being at the top of the tree.
Exactly. Once you get to the top and it happens to be red, no matter what it is, you just say this guy's a black node at the top. So it's really clever, really. There's enough information contained in the coloring that you can pattern match an insert that's assumed to be red. Notice, because you're pattern matching these four cases, that something was a red-red violation. Replace it with something, constant time. You're just matching something and replacing it. And preserve the order of all of the subtrees, and then that just sort of bubbles up to the top. And all of a sudden that insert keeps the shape of that tree relatively balanced. So it's not really too tough to implement that. You just need to be able to, if you were inserting something, be able to match these four cases. What it is interesting and useful, like for optimizing this performance, is you're always doing something on either the left side or the right side, because it's ordered and it's binary and it's either less than or greater than. And these are all things that are on the left side, and these are all things that are on the right side. So you can split this to make the performance better. If it's something in the right tree, only match against these two cases. If it's something in the left tree, only match against these two cases. And then you can basically double the speed of the insert, because you're not going through all the cases all the time.
So the color of the node is not some sort of inherent property of the thing I'm modeling. because I can arbitrarily change it somehow or other, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
In the real world, if I'm taking this into the real world. So it's not like something that's going to be inherently like male, female, or
no,
whatever.
Yeah. It's a throwaway thing that gives you indication of the structure of the of it. It's enough information that you can preserve, or you can make some sort of claim of preserving structure.
So when I'm constructing the tree originally, do I assign the colors mm-hmm. properly so that I can come back and play this game?
Yes.
To balance the tree?
Whenever you start, you're going to do like an insert, and the insert's just going to be a red node that has a value and two empty subtrees. And the next time you do an insert, you would do something like maybe it's a, you know, it's going to be a red node that has the value 4 or something. The first one is value 1, second's value 4. So you end up with the two red nodes and kind of going down the right side of the tree. And then you say, well, you know, this invariant is not being met. I can't have this red on red thing. So you replace it with a tree that works. So it's basically a temporary register for structure. It doesn't really have any particular meaning other than as you insert things, you can match against it and then restructure.
Yeah, I know. It's all done so that I can next iteration, whether I'm doing a delete or insert, I can be more optimal about balancing the tree.
Mm-hmm.
So I keep that structure sort of whole each time I do it and then rebalance it. So it's more of an algorithm rather than trying to model
mm-hmm.
the real world, I think.
So in your 4 trees listed there, those are conditions for inserting, right? So when you insert, you should check and see if the structure of your subtrees look like those.
Yes.
So basically to see if is there the case where there's always a case where you properly inserted, right, as well? Those are all errors.
Yes.
Right.
Okay. There are some cases where you don't have to do this little routine.
Gotcha.
If you, like for example, if you were going to insert 12 and this guy only had, both of these were empty to start with,
right,
you might not need to evaluate
okay.
these.
Okay.
So
there's only be like a few base cases.
There's some base cases, the easy cases, and then this is more of the
okay, trivial base cases versus the complicated ones.
That's interesting. That's kind of worth meditating over, like just how, like, the operation's kind of stupid and you kind of see it, but you have to think of it in terms of how the recursion on it's going to work, how these are going to make something with the red on top, and that'll percolate back up through the tree and structure it again.
So you have two colors in a binary tree.
Mm-hmm.
If you had, say, a trinary tree, would you have 3 colors and you could play the same sort of game in kind of a more complicated
sure that's MP
world?
Or something.
I would imagine. People don't seem to use colors for the other tree types, but I usually they look more directly at the structure than having this kind of phony color thing going on. But yes, you generally have to carry more information. And there's very curious ways, in my opinion, how people carry that more information on some of those sorts of games. Like in these folks who come up with these tree balancing schemes are alarmingly clever. Because like one other kind of tree that's pretty commonly used is a tree that has the 2 values and 3 potential children. And the way you track some of these changes in the structure of a tree like that is noticing if you needed one or, you know, the absence of a value in here can give you a clue about the structure below it. Because if you had, how this tree works is this value, I'll just make these real numbers. That's not the right number. So if there was a value on the left, this subtree would have to be things that are smaller. This one in the middle would be bigger. And then this guy has to be a larger value than this. And everything over here has to be even larger. And what's interesting about these trees is the way you notice how the structure works is based on absence of something. This tree would behave and match differently if there wasn't a value here than if there was. It just gives you that slack space, kind of like the red nodes do, to be able to put in an extra number and an extra child. So you can carry a lot of similar information in a lot of different ways in some of these trees. I'm not sure why people really get giddy over red-black trees and why I fell into that crowd too, but they're kind of neat. And this, you've got a lot more cases because you're matching, does it have this value, does it have this value, does it have this or this child? And at least with the binary order trees, you have relatively small number of cases.
So we're running in a deterministic world here. What happens if those values are actually probability distributions? How does that change this? You'd have to go, instead of an algorithm, to some sort of simulation that you run multiple times to see how this sort of works out, kind of thing? You understand what I'm talking about?
I do, and I'm not sure.
Okay.
That sounds reasonable. I don't know how that would generally play out. Generally, they're very deterministic.
You couldn't take the just expected values, because that gets into what's called the flaw of averages and stuff. So you'd have to just, I think that would be the only choice you'd have in terms of trying to determine what the structure and how it works out and how you would rebalance it, kind of thing. You'd have to almost do some sort of process simulation across that, come out with something or other on the other end. That's kind of interesting. Okay.
That'd be fun to kind of dig into that. I don't really know. It seems like you'd probably end up with at least a certain likelihood of a improperly balanced tree or something.
Yeah.
Maybe. Hard to say.
Yeah. That's why you simulate it. You can't say it.
If we're going to do deletes, it's the beginning of deletes is pretty similar to the beginning of deletes with any ordered binary tree. What usually is done, there's a lot of ways people take to solve this tree issue. And the color thing is just kind of phony anyway. There's nothing like magic or special about red and black or anything. And there's not really, I mean, it's just something humans created to be able to track what the tree does. So we've talked about red and black, and basically red is something that you can pull slack out of. What's pretty commonly done with the delete cases is make this phony guy called double black. And then so what you do with double black is if you had a case where you have a tree who has, that's a two-step process. The insert was a two-step process. You did is sort of not very interesting for the first step. You did the regular insert, and then you go back and look and see if there were double red violations. With this double black thing, what you do is, this guy's actually black, is if you had a red node, you restructure it and you call the red node a black node. So, oops, wrong color here. You can restructure this. This has, we're going to delete this guy. I don't know really how best to show that. This guy is going to get deleted. And you're going to be left with, what you can do is you can have this sort of situation that's left. There's this node over here, turns out to be this node. This node, child here, ends up would be this guy, and what am I doing? And this guy has this guy's two children, whatever. But what was important was when you did this reorganization for the delete, you took a, may as well use the pens. you took a red node and you turned it into a black node while you were restructuring it. And likewise, if you did something with the black version of this, this is hard to draw. You end up with a double black. So you're just, I don't know how you want to call it, adding a color. Red turns to black turns to double black, and much like you ended up with the double red violation of the invariant, then you end up with a double black invariant violation. And when you look at this thing, you can pattern match against these double blacks to make something that looks like a more structured tree. And it is proving, while I have practiced this, I have not practiced drawing this, and it is proving to be very challenging to draw this. So I'm not going to really dwell on these cases. There's a bunch of cases, both for doing the promotion from reds to blacks to address all of the structures, kind of like there were the four cases with the relatively chunky trees. There's a bunch of cases there, and there's a bunch of cases going from double black back to a more structured tree. So I have to apologize for kind of pooping out on the leaf cases, but they're fairly numerous, and knowing that you're doing something similar kind of gets you most of the way there, other than figuring out what all of the cases are.
So on the insertion case, so you can also, so I guess you were describing inserting one node into a tree, but what if you're inserting an entire tree into a node?
You would always be inserting general, well, in this
so you,
presentation,
so,
you're always inserting just one value into it.
One value at a time? So you would insert the entire tree one value at a time. Gotcha.
There's a lot of techniques available for splicing in a tree into another tree,
right,
but you've got to check that makes sense for that tree. Like if you had, and you wanted to insert, then that would make sense because you could just make him the child.
Right.
But if you wanted to add in there's no real simple way to do it because you'd have to break this tree down and then add the values.
So you can't run your checks recursively back up through every tree and fix it timely.
Not every tree.
Okay.
There's a lot of very interesting things people do with trees that are operations you wouldn't even hardly think make sense on trees, like being able to splice trees together to make other trees and so forth. And they're really not horrendously time-consuming algorithms for the most part, because at worst, any operation is the height of the tree, or if it's maybe splicing two trees, something about the height of the one and something about the height of the other.
Two times the height of the tree, yeah.
And so you can get a lot of these sorts of things done fairly rapidly, but not necessarily for, you can't do it easily necessarily for every possible splice like that. And if you did this, you might have some troubles with some of the invariants, because maybe, I don't know if you would or not. If this was a proper red-black tree, you could and it actually made sense as a child of this guy, then you might could color this guy red and then do your regular insert recursion on it. Because then if this were a red, it would pull up. But I don't know.
The problem you run into, I think, is if you only had one option that meets the invariant thing, that's fine. But if you have 14 options that meet the invariants, if you have a very complicated set of trees, you know, then what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
I think that would be the real problem in terms of how do you optimize over those 14 choices. I mean, then it gets to be, okay, what am I doing, modeling and yada yada yada, the model building process. Are there packages out there that allow you to, like an OCaml or Python or something like that, that allow you to sort of do these kinds of operations, or are you slinging your own code to kind of do this sort of stuff?
And see,
if somebody's written algorithms in a book, you have to write your own code, or are there already existing packages out there that allow you to play with this stuff?
I think that they're sort of are and sort of aren't. It's very hard to find something that's a really encompassing sort of, oh, I'm doing a red-black tree. But there's a lot of application-level things that use red-black trees, like the priority scheduler for operating system is notoriously red-black tree-driven because it has very quick insert. I mean, on the whole, insert and delete are very quick with red-black trees, and they're not really all that worried if it's a little imbalanced. So there's a fairly small number of applications of these, and you don't see them much for just sort of, I would like a toy tree to play with, because people, I think, generally are not all that interested in looking at the tree structure and seeing if it's what they thought it would be. They're really interested in the end result more than the data structure. So what I've seen, operating system schedulers tend to be balanced binary trees, and I'm not saying this is an incredibly common thing, but if you want something that's fairly fast storage that works sort of like a hash, but for a large number of values, a balanced binary tree is probably a good choice. Because if you were doing a regular hash, at some point or other you have a higher probability of collisions, and at some point you're just not going to want to allocate that much space for constant structure. And it seems like in most languages, hash map stuff sort of taps out at around a half million or a million values in a hash. And once you get past that, usually your options that are practical are something more along the lines of some sort of dictionary that's based on a tree. So you find these with, like you might have, depending on what the language is, you might have something that's like a sort of generic dictionary that's not hash bank based, and it might implement a red-black tree in order to do that. But you'd have to be pretty, usually people don't really dwell much on what their implementation was for the tree. The one other thing that I was wanting to show is, so all this was about inserting numbers generally, or at least things that work with greater than and less than. Nothing really wrong with inserting character strings and stuff like that. But we can go through a progression, say, of some of these code items real quick, like if this would turn back on. Oh, this TV turn on. I guess so. I have to wait while this thing loads back up on this coding.com. Just to kind of see like where the complex steps really kind of get in there, like the linked list, jumping from a linked list to the ordered binary tree is not a real big jump, but when you start getting into the balancing, it becomes quite a bit bigger of a jump. And then I wanted to show how, like, most people don't really care that much about a list of numbers. Do I have my favorite number in the list? Is it there? I mean, if you were a operating system scheduler, you're pretty interested in that because maybe it represents a PID or something, but a lot of times you'd be interested in something more along the lines of a dictionary. So I made a dictionary case too, and it's a really easy jump from a red-black tree to a red-black dictionary. You basically just make a type that has the key and the value in it, and then you do your red-black tree based on the key, and you add a new function that gives you back values, not just tests its membership. So, a linked list has a type that's either empty or it's a node that has a value crossed with the linked list type itself. And then the code to do it's pretty not so bad. If you're inserting something, you have a case if your value is less than the case you're on, greater than the case you're on, or equal to. And when you're deleting something, if you match that item, then you're just going to splice the thing out of there. And then I wrote some cases, test cases. And generally with trees, these test cases are kind of a bunch of hooey because it's very hard to pick test cases that adequately cover all of the options for especially balanced trees. So what's generally done is, that I did not do, is write some functions that will test the invariants. And then you can build really big trees and test that it actually worked out right. But these static test cases are fun and easy to write if you're a human, but they don't do you a whole lot of good. If you're an ordered tree, you're either an empty node, or you're a node that's a tree, a value, or a tree. Membership is almost the same thing, except you're recursing on both the members to the left and to the right. So you just got to do both of those subtrees instead of just the one recursive structure thing. Insert, if you're empty, you just make a node that has empty in your value. If you're less than something, then you, I mean, I wrote this a little funny. X is the guy who you're inserting. X prime is the guy who you're at. So if X is bigger, you're on the right. So you just add, you just kind of recurse on the things inserting to the right. If it was on the left, you recurse inserting on the left. And if it was equal, then this really, it's the same thing. The node with the left, the value in the right. If it's the same, it's just, you know, giving you back what you already had. With your delete case, this guy, the recursive min function, just tells you what the minimum value is on the left. You could also have done this with the one that looks at the largest whatever on the right child. And then the delete case, if you're a node that has two empty children, you're just empty. And if you're any other kind of node, you just do some of this comparison with the value. And you either propagate the delete down to the right, propagate the delete to the left, or else you find what the minimum value was. If you matched it, that's the guy you want to delete. And then you replace the value X that you had with this minimum value and propagate the deleting down to the right. And I love this kind of recursive stuff personally because it's a little interesting to get the feel for, but once you do, I mean, it reads just like what you do. If I've got my node on, if my value I'm trying to delete is bigger than what I've got, I'm going to return a node that deletes the right to the right. And that's what you do. You're going to delete the stuff, you're going to try this delete thing to the node, child node on the right. And then there's some test cases. And then this, the horror show starts here. So with this, you've also got a type for the color. And the color ends up being in the actual type that you're using. Membership is the same as it always was before. The insert, this stuff down here, the actual insert statement, is really pretty similar to what it was before. It's just, it makes use of these matching statements that match those four cases. And it's broken up into the ones for on the left and the ones for on the right, because otherwise you're matching against excessive cases that waste time. And anytime you insert anything, you're always going to call it a black node at the top. When it propagates up to the top, it'll always get replaced with black no matter what it is. Delete now is where the fun really starts. Much like the ordered binary tree, you need to be able to find the minimum value in the subtree. And there's some convenience functions. I want to know the thing on the left. Well, I don't really want to do this pattern matching all the time in the middle of some other pattern matching. So left is just a function that gives you the left subtree if it exists. Right gives you the right subtree. Add a B will turn an empty thing into an empty double B
a red into a node with a B and a black node into a double black node. Remove a B does exactly the opposite. Is a B just tells you if it was a B or not. Is a red tells you if it's red or not. Just things to help with our test cases. And then the real guts of the thing is all these conditional cases that you have to go through in order to hit all of the possibilities of having turned something from black to double black, red to black, and then rebalance it. So it's, if you can enumerate all of these cases on paper and see how the recursion goes, it's not really that big of a deal to write the expressions out. But just sort of looking at it, not knowing the cases, is like, what is that schmutt up there? And then the delete statement matches the original cases that you need to have. And then there's some tests. But the thing that I was going to draw attention to is when you're doing these sort of tests here, X is just some value that may or may not be a member of that tree. You're testing X. If you wanted to make this thing into a dictionary, you could make a data type that has a key and a value. The only modification you have to do in the entire thing is use the key value instead of the just plain integer value. And then you're totally set. Everything else is basically identical except for the comparisons. In the real world also, since you asked about the real world, generally people like OCaml is really excellent with polymorphic types. And in here, the tick A could be anything. Anything that actually would compile if you use that type, like you're not using less than with something that doesn't have a less than that makes sense or something like that, would be a completely valid thing to do. And it's very flexible because you can just specify a polymorphic type and it will infer it from how you use it. The one thing that you have that you can't do that with for arbitrary types is greater than and less than, which of course work fine with integers and floating point and strings and stuff. But if you wanted to get a little crazy with it, what generally is done is you make a comparison function that'll return greater than, equal to, or less than, and then write everything in terms of the comparison function. And then whatever type you've ever wanted ever in your life, you can make it work with that, as long as you can define that ordering. But what people generally do is, and it's probably one of the very strongest things in a language like OCaml, is you can use the functors to get yourself set up to be able to have those be polymorphic. You have a module that has the type that you're interested in and an implementation of to compare, and then you write this code as a functor that will use that type and those compare outputs, the less than, greater than, and equal to, and then you can build anything you want. If you can make a module that has a type, if you have natural ordering on, I don't know, based on deliciousness or average weight of animals by species or whatever you want, and you can make that type make sense, can pass it through your functor and you'd have a tree based on it. So that's usually what you see like in the wild. And I've been thinking, since I haven't done it, before I post this code, I'll probably take the tree, the balance tree, and make it a functorized addition. So it's a little bit more versatile, and there's another thing to look at if a person wants to. But thank you for coming. I'm sorry it takes so long to talk about the trees, but it's just, I got into it making this presentation, and it was like so important because it's not just about balancing this tree, but all these problems a person wants to do where I want it to run well on my two core processor. I want it to, you know, I want to be able to do bigger problems. And the only thing you see anymore is more cores, more cores, more cores. So knowing about problems and how to break them down into parts like this really is important. Next time, I was kind of thinking on doing a sort of lighter and shorter presentation on, in OCaml, on streams and thunks and lazy evaluation.
And then maybe, like OCaml, that's not default to doing lazy evaluation. You have to sort of coax it into it. But languages like Haskell default to lazy evaluation, so maybe there could be a little compare contrast or something going on with a language where you have to want to do that versus one that you have to not want to do that. Sort of see benefits, pitfalls, and that sort of stuff. And it would probably be quite a bit shorter than this one. Are there questions, comments, concerns? There is a cool tool, which I don't remember the link to, and I'll try to find it and could post it to the meetup thing or something, where somebody had made this kind of cool graphical thing where you could put like a number in and push the insert button, and it had this animated thing that would color the nodes and then bounce the thing down, like you, it would kind of dwell at the stake nodes you were at, and be like, oh, I'm comparing this, not the right one, comparing it, not the right one, oh, here it is, and it would color it the way it would color, and then it would do that on the way back up as it was restructuring the tree, and I thought that was pretty neat.
Yeah.
So if I can find that link again, then I'll shoot it along too, because it was pretty cool, and pretty, I don't know, not like instructive in the sense of enumerating the things that you have to, you know, identify for matching, but it's really fun to watch it if you put a bunch of things in there, especially if you do, like, probably the most compelling, fun case, I think, when you do stuff with a tool like that is you just put in the sequential numbers, you're just like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,
yeah, watch it fix it all.
And then, like, you're anticipating a naive order tree going like this. But when you have the restructuring, it's really pretty neat, because once you get to like 15, the tree is perfectly balanced. And it just does a good job at it. That's all I've got. If anybody else wants